c'est bon, on a fait ce formula. Je vais effacer la glace. Donc, avec la prochaine étape, je vais dire, on peut pas passer si je veux le souhaite. Je suis d'accord, je vais venir envoyer quelque chose. On arrête. Si je suis prêt, je vais envoyer quelque chose. Je suis en solution, je vais pas faire de problème. Je vais faire un exclus, je vais essayer de l'arbre pour pouvoir vous donner plein de choses.
Actually, I have a linear evolution, and this approximation is true if your
If you take into account that you are returning not to be with respect to the feeling of this equation. So precisely, and we also assume that C11, C1L, 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 Ensuite, if you have some approximation, and what's interesting is that the range of the approximation is given by the first profile, by the only non-scattering profile, by the non-scattering. So now, I will change the sequence.
Yeah,
I'm
on that
line. By definition, E of CN has the energy of this profile, the solution of the non-linear wave equation, which is the only profile that doesn't scatter, and I take the energy of it. And now, I consider all the sequence CN, and along all the sequence, I take the minimum of the energy of CN. So I write like this. The minimum of all sequence CN, of the scale of CN, when I say all sequence CN, it's all sequence CN going to the sequence of CN. Okay, and that's the composition. That the following step, the following step is not that if I consider the sequence CN, such that the CN equals the minimum energy. This is not empty. And if CN N is in this set, then at the end, you want to specify.
Thank you.
I'd like to start by thanking the organizers for the invitation. So I'd like to today I'm thinking about joint works with some collaborators around how players are Roma. I'd like to continue the same direction that Nicola has started, which is studying nonlinear dispersive equations in situations when there is a confinement that is either coming from the domain or from a confining potential. And the reason why this question is quite important is that if we think about it, as we all know, if we study this nonlinear dispersive equation from RT, then dispersion is a mechanism for non-dissipative GK. This means that at least at the linear level, you have the linear solution GK in an infinity like g to the minus alpha for some alpha positive. And this GK is the reason behind all nonlinear asymptotic stability of equilibrium solutions on us. By this I mean that starting from small, smooth initial data, then one can show that solution remains small in all pretty much all sensible norms, and we can often describe the asymptotic behavior, at least when you have sufficient GK, which is typically linear scattering. However, this picture changes completely if you study nonlinear dispersive equations on complex domains. On complex domains, we can have no escape. The wavefunction components of the solution have no escape from interacting indefinitely with each other, particularly there is no infinity for those wavefunctions to escape to. And as a result, dispersion does not translate into GK either at the linear nor at the nonlinear level. And this complicates things quite considerably. And the consequence of that is that you lose all asymptotic stability results of the equilibrium solution that you have on RG. And the only control that you can retain, the only global control that you can retain on the solution is the one that is coming from conserved quantities, which if your system is not integral, there are very few, then they are typically at the level of L2 or H1. And not only you lose the proof of the stability of those equilibrium solutions, you don't expect those equilibrium to be stable in the long run, in particular out of equilibrium dynamics is anticipated. And starting even from very, very small neighborhoods of the origin in your phase space, you can already observe many characteristics in different behaviors, such as KM or I or several of the behaviors that we'll be talking about today. And the main problematic here is how to understand, explain or capture this out of equilibrium dynamics. One main aspect of it is that of energy cascade. Energy cascade means that the energies of the system, while remaining conserved, they will move their concentrations on in characteristics different landscape. Let me explain this for the forward cascade of energy, which was in this domain as well. So the forward cascade of energy means that the energy will migrate from low frequency concentration zones to high frequency concentration zones. And in this case, this means that the energy will move from large scales to very small scales. So theoretically speaking, we are thinking of the solutions that we were interested in solutions that are initially operated at scale order one, but at some later time they start oscillating at much, much more scales. And the main question is how do we capture this cascade, or more generally how to understand the output from dynamics. And as far as I know, there has been two approaches in the mathematics and physics communities in order to capture this or to answer this question. The first approach was based on a relation between the growth of Sobolev norms of solutions and the energy cascade phenomena. And this relation can be explained as follows. If we look at the definition of the Sobolev norm over here, suppose we are working on the torus equals simplicity. Of course, this is nothing but the sum of all L2 norms of derivatives of order alpha q, but it will be more illuminating for us to look at this formulation in Fourier space over here. If we look at this factor, 1 plus n squared to the x, this factor penalizes obviously high frequencies much more than it penalizes low frequencies. So the energies of the system are moving towards high frequencies, and this has to be accompanied by this growth from Sobolev norm. And here many people contributed to this approach, starting from the pioneering work of Burjan Stafilani, who obtained bounds on the growth, as Nicolai explained at the beginning of this talk. There were also contributions of Kupchen, Koliander, Gilles, Tanata, Rokantau, myself, Schroinger, Kalosha, and Gravia, and then the results that Nicolai discussed. The second approach, which was, I would say, was more popular in the physics literature, is the effective dynamics approach. And it's based on the following idea. It's based on the idea that the long-term dynamics is extremely rich when you're working on a compact domain, that they have no chance of making uniform statements about the dynamics, about the long-term dynamics, let alone the asymptotic dynamics. So the next best thing to do is to try and find order in the scale, and try to identify certain regimes where you can say something about the long-term dynamics. And one way to do that is to derive a effective equation for the dynamics in those regimes by taking various limits of your resistance. We talked about some instances of this approach, actually this is the main subject of this talk, but I should say that the most well-known instance of it is a physical theory, it's called by the name of wave or mean turbulence theory. The equations of wave turbulence have been written at least in the first part of the half century by Pierre Lachman, but the theory was mostly integrated by Zakharov and his students and collaborators at his school in general. There's also contributions to Newell, Maidan, and Glass, and Tavares. Of course, this is not exhaustive, but it's very new, very huge. Lucarian and Spohn, probably Velasquez as well, and others. Nicolai gave us a very nice discussion about the first approach, so I would like to talk about the second approach today, which is the effective dynamics approach. But before we start discussing those issues, let us fix the model equation on which we will take the analysis, and this is the same equation that Nicolai was considering. We consider it in 2D, cubic linear solid equation, and we will consider it on a box of type L with periodic boundary conditions. So the equation is over here. The solution, so we won't be interested in the existence questions of the solution, but also this will be talking about existence globally in time. At least it will stick for small demand, by the way, as we conserve quantity for this equation. And this is something that was proved by Rogan and Fee. The sign of the nonlinearity won't be of importance to us, partly because we are restricting to such small solutions, and indeed our aim is to understand output equilibrium dynamics of such small solutions. And for this, we'll adopt the answer, g is equal to epsilon u, and think of u as having size 1 in L2 norm, in order to emphasize the size of the solution. And the only difference is that you have an epsilon squared term on the right side of the equation. So I just said, well, let's say the frequency dynamics of solutions, so we'll be interested in how this equation looks like in Fourier space, which is something that also Nicolai wants. Okay, so what we'll do is that we'll expand your sense of the Fourier series, which is like 1 over L squared, the sum of k is d2 over L. This is what we work on the concept of like L, d2 over L of the other lower. And k is nothing but the Fourier transform of Q. So if you take the Fourier transform of the equation, this is IVTU, this is the Fourier transform of the Laplacian, and this is the Fourier transform of the linearity, this is another composition. So here's the sum is over k1 minus k2 plus k is equal, plus k3 is equal to k. If you look at this equation, on the right hand side. So we do the natural step, which is called the interaction representation step. This means that we conjugate by just a linear flow. We find AKST to be 4 pi squared I, K squared T multiplied by CK. And in this just coordinate, the equation is satisfied by AK is essentially the same as that of CK, except that we have removed this linear factor at the expense of introducing this very important sign of the latent factor, T to the minus 4 pi squared I omega T, where omega is K1 squared minus K2 squared plus K3 squared minus K squared. So if you look at this equation, it says that the panel can be written in Fourier space as an infinite system of ODEs. And it predicts the infinite system of ODEs that is how the frequency mode at AK is being expanded by the frequency mode at K1, K2, and K3 in the segment of K. All those interactions and excitations, we've already seen from the previous talk, that there stands out to be a particularly important family of interactions, which is the family of resonance interactions, and these correspond exactly to the triplets K1, K2, and K3 in SOK for which capital omega is equal to 0. And we will see that those interactions play a particularly important role in deciding the long-term dynamics, so we'll motivate us to identify to define the resonance linear Schrodinger system, which is the same as the linear Schrodinger equation, except that you restrict this sum over R of T, which is corresponds to omega equal to U, so this problem. Okay, so these are the two equations that we see interested in for most of the stuff. Okay, so let me start by talking about the effective dynamics approach. And before I go into talking about the recent progress of that approach, let me talk about the most well-known instance of it, which is the theory of wave turbulence. The theory of wave turbulence seeks to give a statistical description of cloud neural dynamics for nonlinear dispersed equations, and it was mostly integrated by Zakharov in the 60s, who was trying to find an analog of almost of theory of hydrodynamic turbulence. And the setup, or one of the setups that you'll find in the system, is that you start with initial data for the nonlinear dispersed system that is given by random variables. So each AK, the frequency mode AK, at time 0 is given by independent time variable for K and Z to the left. And the key quantity to which you would like to understand its dynamics is the so-called wave spectrum, and it's defined as the expectation of AK of T squared. So you start with AK at time 0 to be random, you solve the analytic equation, and then you take the expectation of a two by of AK squared. Again, as we said, the guiding philosophy of this theory is that to find effective equations for N of K by taking various limits of your original system. And if you look at the physics literature, the limits that are done in order to find the effective equation for N of K, this could be split into three types of limits. The first type is the statistical and time averaging stuff. Here I should point out that this is particularly non-linear stuff. The second type of limit that is done is the large box limit. So you start with an electron process like that, and then you let L go to 3D. Oh, sorry. So the K variable that used to be in D2 sub L becomes a continuous parameter in R2. And the last type of limit that is done is the weak nonlinear limit, which essentially entails ignoring some higher order terms in a multiple-time scale expansion math in that which is the first step. Again, okay, so all this derivation is not rigorous and far from being rigorous at this point, but if you do it, this gives an effective equation for the wave spectrum N of KT, which is actually quite important in application. And this is called the wave kinetic equation, or sometimes called the Kolmogorov-Zakharov equation. And as we said, it was derived much earlier than Zakharov. Just, I won't be using it, but just for your curiosity, I read it on this slide. So once you have this equation, you start asking what does it tell you about the long time or not, how to do the dynamics of the nonlinear Schrodinger equation. And indeed, it actually tells you a lot. It tells you surprisingly interesting statements even from the point of view of non-equilibrium statistical mechanics, especially in terms of excitation solutions, which are called spectra. And those spectra can be split into two groups. There are spectra that correspond to thermodynamic equilibria, or for example, just to translate this measure. And you can obviously see that this is a single solution of this, but N of K equals K to the minus 3, you get K1 squared minus K2 squared plus K3 squared minus K squared, and this is still by the delta function over here. So this is not an interesting solution of this equation. The interesting solutions were actually derived by Zakharov, and they carry the name. These correspond to non-equilibrium stationary solutions, and one of them is the direct state spectrum and the linear state spectrum. Let me talk about the direct state spectrum. It corresponds to the existence of a statistically steady state where the energy is being pumped at a constant state from low frequencies towards high frequencies. So this is actually a very strong statement. However, the main caveat of the theory is that it is not rigorous.